And now the time is here to reach the last record. 1942, it's for you. We're here. Hello, everyone. Right on. So, as always with this series, I'm supposed to be giving roughly five weaknesses, and it's on and how I would fix them on January 1st, 1942. As I've done for 39, 40, and 41. There's no prior knowledge, but I'm not restricted in spending. But there again, I can't really spend infinitely. I have to keep it within sort of the characters. And I'm supposed to not use foreknowledge, but I can use anything of the debates at the time and go, well, I would have favored this debate because that's my inclination. It's like, this is going to sound strange. I have an inclination towards certain types of warfare and certain modus operandi, which is will affect the biases and the reasons I chose. Are these from my reading of history? More than likely. Can I disassociate myself therefore completely from foreknowledge? Probably not. But it's as disassociated as I can and based on the arguments. And the reason I often have for following those arguments is because, honestly, I am just slightly more cynical. So, the Royal Navy on the 1st of January 1942 is reeling, okay? They have lost all of these. They are absolutely and utterly quashed. They're either lost or losing these. They've lost Hood. They've lost Barham. Prince of Wales, Repulse. The world is not a good place for them. It just isn't. There is no real chance for them to recover those losses anytime soon. And you can sit there and go back for all these videos and go, well, Alex, you've been using foreknowledge just to argue against carriers the whole way through being paused. I actually, if you remember correctly, the case I used for arguing against carriers being paused was the case which was used at the time. Carriers are essential to anti-submarine warfare for the Royal Navy. By end of 1940, they've learned they're essential for air defense of the Royal Navy. By the end of 1941, they've learned they are essential to the survival of the Royal Navy. This is where the Light Fleet Carrier Program comes from. It doesn't come out of nowhere. It's, look at what we lost. And losses don't stop there. Because arguably, at least, well, probably not this one, although another carry around wouldn't have hurt, and probably not the other top one, but this diagonal, this one, and this one. Well, if the loss is on the next page, specifically this and this, had not been lost, then they could have been in a very different scenario. You lose Crete, you have to have an aircraft carrier for the Mediterranean fleet. There is no real option not to. Crete is your unsinkable aircraft carrier, and you've lost it. You lose Ark Royal as well. Well, that's... I've already been through the number of fleet carriers the Royal Navy has. This is the third large fleet carrier they've lost in the war. Lucky it's the last one they lose, but honestly, that's not good. The Royal Navy lost all this in 1941, and you can put the losses of Repulse and Prince of Wales down to the loss of Crete and Ark Royal. If Ark Royal had still been around, they would have had a carrier with them. Why? Because if you have any more carriers available, that's where one goes. Because it's self-sufficiently obvious at this point. Is it Ark Royal that goes? I doubt it, because she's very useful. But I wouldn't be surprised if one of the armored carriers, slightly smaller,
in terms of his air group, probably one of the first gen armored carriers. Illustrious is in major refit dry dock, but there's Formidable and Victorious at various stages would have been made available because Ark Royal would have been available. If you have Crete available, then that means you can do without a carry if you need to in the Mediterranean for a bit. You have enough aviation support from both sides of the Mediterranean and enough forward aviation support to interdict German strikes that you can do a limited number of operations without carrier support or with reduced carrier support. It's not great, but it's viable. So what do you do in 1941? What are you? Well, you're going to have to do a crash carrier program. Well, that's what they do anyway. That's a light fleet carrier program. Vanguard is going to need to be built. Why? The same reason you need going to need to complete the rest of the King George V quickly enough. Because whilst you could deal with losing Royal Oak and not worry about it, and yes, the Germans have lost Bismarck. The fact is the Germans have built Tirpitz. Scharnhorst and Eisenhower are still theoretically there. Yes, they're in difficulties. One of them is never going to make it to sea again, really. But they're still there, theoretically. And you have now lost five. And, by the way, a little bit of foreknowledge, but we all know a couple more are going to get damaged on this year, thanks to Italian frogmen. So, you're in trouble. You're in major trouble. You need capital ships. Why did the US end up sending capital ships to assist in the convoy escort program when the British sent a carrier to assist the Americans? Simply put, the Americans have capital ships, but not enough carriers because of what's happened to them in their operations. And the British are the other way around. And the British are trying to build carriers as quickly as they can. But it's only so quickly as fast you can build carriers and only so fast you can build capital ships. And it affects both of them. And they've lost an escort carrier. That also has bearing. That's a convoy escort carrier. That's another useful tool. Convoys which have escort carriers, you can be more laissez faire in terms of their major escort units and major units in terms of distant escort, because they're going to see an enemy coming, hopefully from further away. They're going to be better at suppressing submarines, and that is all going to give you more time to react. So losing this is not good. Losing York, not good. But losing Crete, losing Ark Royal, those are big losses. So if you can consider Ark Royal is lost largely because the losses of Glorious, Courageous, and the experienced officers, including especially damage control officers who went down with them, have had a cumulative impact. And you can tell this because the officers now starting to man carriers do not have experience the difficulties of damage control on a carrier, which are different than any other ship because of the location of weight and flammable materials and where they are in the ship. And liquid flammable materials and where they are in the ship. Because if you consider the hangout, they're going to be very high up, which affects your distribution of weight and mass. So, yes. Light fleet carrier program. All based on HMS Unicorn. Should have been started earlier. Would have been good if some surprisingly fast, but of course designed to only do 20 knots, but surprisingly fast sloops have been built earlier. In fact, even if not surprisingly fast sloops, if more sloops have been built earlier, which freed up W&V class destroyers, which were converted into fast escorts to be extra escorts for carrier groups, then you might not have lost Ark Royal. There are lots of decisions, if taken in peacetime, which could have, with very little outlay, have saved a lot of problems for the Royal Navy in wartime. But in 1942, there is very little you can do that they're not already doing. They're still suffering from personnel issues, as mentioned in 1941's discussion. Guess who ends up being sent out to the Indian Ocean to rectify there? Oh yes, Admiral Somerville, the same guy who Churchill has tried to send a court-martial to and various other problems, and various other issues. Why? Because who else is there to send? Who else do you send? There are only so many people who are trained, experienced, and who you have faith in at senior command. And you have currently more commands than you have people. The USA. Production in 1941, low. 1942, big. 1943, massive. And it's the time taking to produce ships as well, which really goes out. If you consider before Pearl Harbor, it takes 38, 39 months to build a battleship. After Pearl Harbor, well, let's be honest, that's 31, 32. Carriers, 31, 32. Average drops down to, we could say 16 months. Submarines drop from 14 down to 7, 8 months. Destroyers, they drop even further, down to 6. And you also have a rather interesting scenario when you look at the authorized fleet versus the fleet actually available and actually built. The USN is a massive case in January 1942 of a navy which has been talked about as being built for war, but hasn't actually been supplied with the resources being promised. And it's just getting this. Its big problems at the moment are buying time to actually get those resources into the water and actually into where they need to be. And that is a problem. Because they're going to need time. None of this is quick. None of this acceleration construction is quick. All of this, it requires experience. And they're doing their best. The loss of the USN so far in 1941 are relatively light. They're devastating because they happened mostly in Pearl Harbor. Well, not Sea Lion and Reuben James here, but, you know, both battleships lost in Pearl Harbor. That home. Supposedly a safe. And the first thing they've got to start doing is building up Pearl Harbor. They've got to start building up supplies. They've got to start surging everything, which is what they do. What would I change from what they did? Nothing, really. There's no good answers. There are no good ways, based on the information you have available, to make things better in January 1942. It's going to be a hard, long slog. Why is it going to be a hard, long slog? Because decisions you should have taken in 1941, 1940, 1939, 1938, 1937, 1936, 1935 were all put off by Congress. Were all put off by various presidencies. For a long, long time. Yes, we have treaties, we have this, we have that. Yes, but how much are they really securing you? And if they're not securing you, why are you still abiding by it? Now, interesting enough, the torpedo issues are hanging a lot on. It takes time to get these things changed. It takes a long time to get these things done. But again, if someone had thought, hang on, what's happened in the first month of war? What are the reports coming in? Let's go check them. Which is pretty much what the Germans did. They might have found themselves in a far safer operating space more quickly. America is in a curious position. They are both a sleeping giant and a hollow tree. They look powerful and sturdy until the wind blows. They have the capacity to fill that tree up. They do. But they haven't. And I often think at the beginning of World War II of their involvement in Japan is surprised by how successful they are. I know there are some bellicose Japanese who go, yes, yes, rah, rah, rah. But there are a fair number who go, hang on, we're getting overextended here. And we're getting overextended because they keep collapsing. And we weren't expecting this. Now, why have I put the Royal Navy Canadian in this? Because the Royal Navy Canadian are on their way to being one of the largest navies in the world by this point. By the end of World War II, they will be the fourth largest navy in the world, behind only the USA, the United Kingdom, and the USSR. The USSR is not being part of these videos. I do realize that that's because they are going to be part of videos which are going to be later in the year, which are going to be discussing a lot of their fleet procurement and are going to be part of my Christmas specials. So, sorry, I decided to exclude them from these videos. Great thing about being the person recording them. They will only end up, though, with two ships larger than destroyers. Uganda and Ontario. Uganda, of course, becomes Quebec. Two cruisers. They will get a carrier after the war. And I think that's the wrong decision. I think cruiser is a great status asset to go for. It sounds really good, but for a navy which is being built around small ships, corvettes and destroyers, going for a cruiser is silly. They go for the right form of cruiser. They don't go for a Dido, which is thankful, but in the nicest way, they really don't, you shouldn't be going for a cruiser at all. Just think of the crew that could be used to man destroyers. Yes, it's a status. We have cruisers. But two cruisers are no real help to Canada. That's what, one for each coast? That's not really any help. It's good for the Royal Navy, because they don't have to man that, they don't have to crew those cruisers, as in the British Royal Navy, but not for the Canadians. For the Canadians, more tribals would be more help. And yes, cruisers provide something major for your captains to get promoted up to, but so does flotilla leader. So do various shore commands. And if necessary, you can always send them off to the Royal Navy, who will always be happy to take any experienced officers to go and become captains, etc., of ships, if they have that option. I think there's a buzzwords in here. So, yeah, the Royal Canadian Navy. Good Navy. Getting massive. And well on their way to it at this point. But they're not doing a good job at bedding themselves in with the public. You know how I notice? Because half the time when I say to a Canadian officer or audience, you once had the fourth largest navy in the world, they laugh. They look at me as if I'm talking with two heads. And this to me speaks of a problem in terms of recruitment and in terms of image and presentation. And they did have problems with the government. There was a constant fight between the person running the Canadian Navy and the Prime Minister of Canada. And that's something which I'd like to do a video about separately at some day, so I'm not going to get into too much detail of that here. But I think, honestly, the RCN were doing a great job of fighting the Battle of the Atlantic. They were absolutely beyond essential for that theatre of war. They were what the Norwegian Navy dreamed of being in many respects, in terms of fighting in that way. But they didn't do a good job of establishing themselves as that nation. They are the other major power, though. Please get this wrong. There's a reason they're on the major allies. The Soviet Union isn't, because the Soviet Union's Navy, let's be honest, is mostly a littoral Navy, and as I said, I'm going to talk about it later in the year. The French can no longer be a major power. The Australians, they do their effort, but they're nowhere. There is a big gap between them and the Canadians. A big, big gap. The Canadians are the fourth largest navy in the world. And that's without any cheating stats and out any dodgy figures. And we have Town Class Cruisers next week. And we have... Well, this has got strange out of date. We'll leave that to one side. Obviously, I forgot to update this one. But, yes, on the 1st of September, 5 ways to fix the fleets of World War II, 1939-1940. That's when that's going to be, the 1st of September. Hope you look forward to it. And the live for this discussion... it's going to be the 16th of September. Take care, everyone. Thank you very much for watching, and I hope you enjoyed. Take care.